Welcome back to It's Down to Business with Jack Miller. Call us at 305-541-2350. Follow us on Facebook at Jack Miller Down to Business or on Twitter at HJackMiller1.
You have chances to serve much more than you grab the ring on the merry-go-round.
Hello, everyone. This is a super, super excited Jack Miller again, back with my main man, Todd Cohen. I can't even tell you how excited I am. That's bad English, Todd.
That is very poor, Jack.
I know, but I'm just so excited to have Kay Warren on the show next. I am absolutely tremendous fans of Kay Warren and her husband Rick Warren and the whole work that she and Rick does at the Saddleback Church.
They literally do God's work.
Well, you know what it is? They reach out and touch people. Regardless, I'm a Jewish guy, you're a Jewish guy, but 90% of what they say, 95% of what they say goes across barriers. And when people, you and I are in the workforce, we're capitalists, so when people give up their lives to help other people, I'm just enthralled by them. I really am. To me,
they are the true royalty in our world.
I agree. I certainly agree, and I'm just super excited. Let's get Mrs. Warren on the phone. Mrs. Warren, are you with us?
I am, and please call me Kay.
Kay, thank you very much. I don't know if you heard the introduction, but I can't.
I did. I'm blushing over here.
Don't blush. I'll tell you, you and your husband are so relatable, and one of the things I like most is you are candid with the issues that you face as individually, as a couple, as a family. And sometimes we're all afraid to admit our weaknesses in public. Like, you know, oh, I'm macho. I don't want to say I'm down or I'm depressed or my life sucks or whatever it may be. So I'm just inspired by the two of you. I really am.
Before we get serious about the holidays, this is Todd, by the way. How did you meet Rick? I mean, did he charm you with his, you know, verbosity, the way that he does with his congregations? Like, how did you guys first meet?
Yeah, he's been charming as long as I've known him. We met when we were 17, and before we finished high school, we were at different high schools in a different part of California. We were at a youth meeting, if you will, in Southern California, and I was impressed by his Billy Graham imitation. And he was not impressed with me at all. I was very shy and quiet. And so we walked away from me thinking, wow, that's a really funny, loud guy. And him thinking, wow, that's a really shy, awkward girl. And then we met again at college a few years later. And I had grown a little. And he certainly hadn't toned down any. But somehow we got together, and so we got married at 21. We just celebrated our 40th wedding anniversary this year.
Wow.
And that is hard to believe. He still makes me laugh like nobody else, drives me crazy, but we're closer than ever, and I adore the socks off him because he never wears socks, so he's amazing.
That's great. Congratulations to you guys, 40 years.
Thank you. Yeah.
I just have to follow up on this because you've been candid in your interviews and say that he's the extrovert and you're the introvert. Did you kind of – how is it being his wife? Did you just – how hard was it to fill the shoes that you're in? Because it seems you're an extrovert now. You're in front of the public all the time. Is that awkward for you or just evolved?
I'm an introvert who learned to adapt to the life that I got myself into. it's, you know, he will always be the extrovert in a crowd of people. He'll work the room, shaking hands, hugging, you know, spending 2 or 3 minutes with every person. I'm much more content to have a, you know, let's solve the world's problems, tell me your soul, you know, kind of stuff with 3 or 4 people in the corner of a room for the whole night. We're very different, but it's been good. It's been hard. As you've said, we've had struggles in our relationship because we are so different. And living in the public eye is not easy, and we've had some losses and some hard things along the way, but truly we're a great team, and I'm really grateful for these 40 years.
Cool. That's nice to hear. You've written, and I want to. This is Christmas Eve Day. It's the holiday of, you know, it's a positive, joyous holiday. And you've written some fantastic books over choosing joy. I want to focus a little bit on that. And if you could give some advice to some folks who are maybe not as joyful as they should be, or who are affected by the life is hard, the trials and tribulations of life. How does someone find the inner happiness and inner peace, and kind of try to put aside the problems that they're facing to be more happy?
Yeah, you know, I could spend about 3 hours just on that one question. I think probably what I'd really love to tell your listeners today, the day before Christmas, is that it's okay to not be all jolly and holly and, you know, all that most wonderful time of the year. It is a wonderful time of the year unless you're in grief, unless you're suffering, unless you're in pain. And then everybody else's great mood and all the, you know, songs that you hear that you're supposed to be feeling great, those can just be like arrows in your heart. And the Bible is just so clear. It talks about in the New Testament that we should weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who are rejoicing. And I think it's really important for us to make room, to make space for those who are mourning, those who are grieving, those who are maybe they've just lost their job, or they've got, you know, they got some really bad news. And so this time of year is not particularly joyful or happy. And yet there are so many people, you get their Christmas card, and man, their Christmas card, their life looks perfect. You know, the family's all smiling, and they've got the job they wanted, and they've got great financial windfall, and their health is wonderful. And so we rejoice with those who are rejoicing and weep with those who weep. And it's okay today if some of your listeners are not feeling quite so merry or quite so happy. But to segue from that, I think that I know I had a complete misunderstanding about joy. I really thought it had to do with personality. You know, people like my husband who were real extrovert, and that me as an introvert, it wasn't going to come as naturally to me. I think the mistake that most of us make is believing that joy is all about the externals, the people in our lives, you know, if our relationships are good, what we possess, you know, what position we have, do we have the job that we want, our personality, where we live. I think that we get caught up in all of those external things. And the problem with that is that every single one of those can change, be lost, or be broken. And that's the difference to me between happiness and joy. Happiness is going to be if the people in my life are happy with me, if I've got the job I want, if I've got enough money, if my health is good, if I live in a place I really like, if I get the respect I want at work, those things are going to make me happy. But knowing that it all can be lost or broken or changed, I've got to have something more stable, something much more steady and dependable that cannot be taken away. And so for me, joy is really rooted in God, because He's the only unshakable reality in our world that is constantly shifting under our feet.
So your new book is called Choose Joy, and we noticed when we got you on the line that your assistant's name is Joy. Was that a job requirement?
Am I good or what?
Was that a job requirement that you had?
That's exactly right. Didn't want anybody named Happy. I had to have somebody named Joy.
Got it. Now, what's Christmas like at your house? I mean, take us through that. Is it just family? Do you open your home up to friends and people from, you know, all walks of life? How do you guys celebrate Christmas?
That's a really great question. Rick preaches multitude of Christmas Eve services. In fact, our very first Christmas Eve service started on Tuesday of this week. So on Tuesday, we had a Christmas Eve service. We had Christmas Eve services yesterday on Wednesday. Today, we have, I think it's 7 or 8 on our Lake Forest campus. But we have 16 different churches, if you will, campuses. And so there'll be like 40 services based over those. So Christmas Eve is very hectic. And years ago, I had to give up the little personal traditions that we had on Christmas Eve so that we could bring a message of hope to everybody else on Christmas Eve. So by the time Christmas Day rolls around, we are pooped. We are exhausted. And we keep it pretty simple. We have my kids, my grandkids, extended family, friends in the area who come, but it's pretty casual. I end up ordering food from a restaurant. I gave up the big Christmas dinner and order food from a restaurant on Christmas Eve, pick it up today, warm it up tomorrow morning. Fun family, the Christmas story, hearts full of gratitude. One of probably the best things that we do during the Christmas season for us as a family is we have a birthday party for Jesus. And when Rick was 3 years old, he said to his mom in his best little three-year-old boy voice, you know, if it's Jesus's birthday, why don't we have a party for him and have angel food cake and Kool-Aid and sing happy birthday? So for the last, you know, he's 61, so for the last, 58 years, his family and then our family and now our kids' families all have a birthday party for Jesus where we talk about what is it that we're grateful for in this past year and what is it that we would like to give. If Christmas is a time of giving and receiving, what is it we would like to give to Jesus for his birthday? And we talk about, you know, it's always things where we want to grow, it's places where we want to change, it's places where we want to be kinder, you know, better people. So that's a really special tradition in our family.
Sounds great.
You know, you mentioned before that that when you look at someone else's life, you know, their vacations, their jobs, everything looks good. I have a theory that, you know, on Facebook, no one ever puts the bad stuff. No one ever puts, I'm fighting with my spouse or my kids or my brother or my job stinks or I have economic problems. And I think social media is sort of problematic in that way, that we look at somebody else and says, what a great life they lead, and it makes us feel bad. And I think that everyone has problems, and if you don't know their problems, you don't know them well enough. And I think
Absolutely. I think that creates a dissonance within us, because we do. We look at the externals of other people's lives, compare them with the externals and the internals, you know, in our lives, and usually, you know, come up lacking. Or at the very least, I think it creates problems between friends. Wait, you invited her to go to that? You didn't invite me. And it's definitely a mixed blessing. And there's wonderful things about it. But, you know, I see pictures of my grandkids. I might not see any other way. But it also can create a jealousy and a disconnect when the whole effort is supposedly to be connecting people.
Right, it's dangerous.
How do people focus on the inner joy more? I want to focus on this because, again, if maybe someone's going through a troubled marriage or whatever, or they lost their job or whatever bad is happening called life, or their parents are sick or they're depressed, what do you think the best way is to really, I don't know, shake themselves out of it? You know, in the Jewish religion, depression, you're supposed to shake yourself away as much as you can from depression, literally run away from it. And I know that sounds easy, but how do you think it's practical to try to surround yourself with positive things and upbeat things as much as possible?
Well, I might look at life through a little bit different lens than that, because of my work with people living with mental illness, our son's mental illness. I'm in my own struggle with depression, low levels of depression my whole life. I think that we do ourselves a disfavor when we try to ignore what's really going on inside of us. And I think there's that fine line between being so introspective that, you know, we're just navel gazers and we never get our gaze off of ourselves. And that's certainly a dead end, and joy will not be experienced in that place. But on the other hand, to deny or to try to suppress or push away our feelings of either sadness or grief or the pain and suffering. I mean, life is really hard. You said it a few minutes ago. Life is hard. And when we ignore that and deny that, then I think that we don't even have, we're not even planting the right seeds in our heart to experience joy. Joy has a lot to do with being grateful. And I challenge you to find anybody who is full of ingratitude and also experiences joy. Those two cancel each other out. And so rather than saying denying that I'm feeling sad or denying that I'm feeling depressed or whatever, I'm trying to learn how to welcome the totality of what I'm feeling, sadness, grief, loss, worry, anxiety, and at the same time, look for where also can I be grateful. I compare life much more than to hills and valleys where you've got good times and bad times and, you know, it being cyclical. I look at it as more that life is more about parallel train tracks, that on a train track, there's a track of joy and there's a track of sorrow, and a train goes down both of those tracks every moment of our lives. So in the moments in which I am experiencing sadness or worry or depression, at that exact moment, if I will open my eyes, if I will look at my world through eyes of gratitude, I will also find beauty and love. And man, there's a sunset to kill for over there. That is the most spectacular thing I've ever seen, and it lifts my spirits. And at the same time, on the reverse, in the moments when I'm feeling such absolute joy in the fact that I have a relationship with God who is unshakable and that he is in control of the details of my life and I can choose gratitude, I'm also aware on that painful side of the tracks, there is also something probably missing in every experience. And it's the challenge for us as human beings is to learn how to ride those parallel tracks of joy and sorrow at the exact same moment. We don't deny the sorrow, and neither do we try to just live on the joy side. We embrace joy and sorrow as a part of daily life and find a way to push through on both of those tracks. And in so doing, I think then we're the most balanced that we'll ever be.
Right. Look, we're running up against it, but just want to get real quick your favorite Christmas song and your favorite Christmas movie.
My favorite Christmas movie is White Christmas, Bing Crosby, Danny Kaye, Vera Allen, and Rosemary Clooney. I have to watch it every year, and if I can watch it more than once, I will. There's just something, I don't know, sweetly magical about, and I love the music. So that's my favorite Christmas movie. My favorite Christmas carol, gosh, I love them all. I play the piano, and so every chance I get, I'm playing one or the other of them. Probably Joy to the World is my favorite one. Joy to the World, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Those are deeply meaningful words to me.
Mrs. Warren, okay, I really appreciate you being with us. We only have a minute or two left. What's your Christmas message to all our listeners and all humanity?
To really this next year, understand, and I have to come from my own faith tradition, it is Christmas, that the creator of the world, this huge infinite God invaded our very broken humanity and became one of us so that we could have a relationship with him that would last into eternity. And that is a cause for celebration, it's a cause for joy, it's a cause for hope. And I pray a blessing on all of your listeners for a very happy and joyful 2016.
Kay, I pray the same blessing on behalf of the Warren family, the Saddleback family, and all our listeners and all humanity. I can't thank you enough for being with us today. It really meant a lot to me. And I would encourage everyone go to besides SaddlebackChurch.com, kwarren.com, and you'll be inspired as much as I was. Thank you, everyone. And I want to wish everyone a very, very extra special Merry Christmas this year.
That's right. And a Happy New Year. Take care.
Todd, Merry Christmas to you, my
friend. Merry Christmas to you,
my Jewish friend.
Don't turn that dial. We will be right back.
Are you tired of dealing with unreliable banks and brokers who charge upfront fees and never deliver on their promises? You don't have to. Gelt Financial Corporation has been in business since 1989 and offers a stated income loan program for non-owner-occupied residential and commercial real estate investors. No tax returns required. What are you waiting for? Call Gelt Financial right now at 561-221-0900. Again, that's 561-221-0900. 561-221-0900.
If you're buying, selling, or investing in real estate, call attorney Dan Kaskow. 561-237-6822. Mr. Kaskow is board certified by the Florida Bar as an expert in real estate law. He's been practicing law for more than 20 years and is a partner in the law firm of Sachs Kaplan with offices in Boca Raton and Tallahassee. Dan Kaskow handles real estate, corporate, condominium, and homeowner association matters throughout Florida. From residential purchases and sales, bulk buying and selling of condominium units, to purchases and sales of commercial properties, contact attorney Dan Kaskow at 561-237-6822 for your real estate, corporate, and community association legal needs. Attorney Dan Kaskow, 561-237-6822. Non-attorney spokesperson for attorney Dan Kaskow.
Did you invest in a non-liquid real estate partnership? Do you want and need liquidity? There's finally an answer. Quick Liquidity is a direct buyer of real estate minority interest and tenants in common investments across the country. To find out if we would buy your non-liquid investment, call us at 561-221-0881 or visit us at quickliquidity.com. That's quickliquidity.com.
Welcome back to It's Down to Business with Jack Miller. Hey! Call us at 305-541-2350. Follow us on Facebook at Jack Miller Down to Business or on Twitter at HJackMiller1.
You have chances to serve much more than you grab the ring on the
Todd, I must confess, I was nervous doing a Christmas Eve show. I was scared we were going to mess it up, but I think it was fantastic. We had some good guests. You have any Christmas thoughts, any Christmas message
Look,
for everyone?
Look, I mean, I think we should be subject to the same rules our guests were, so I guess I'll come forth with my favorite Christmas song, my favorite Christmas movie. I happen to be partial to Little Drummer Boy as a song. I think that song is fantastic. Every time I hear it, it definitely takes me to this time of year. And when I hear it this time of year, it just brings a smile to my face. And by the way, it should be said that the music and movies and everything pop culture relating to holiday season is great. I mean, it's one of the reasons why I love the holidays. And these images that they conjure and the times when you're younger and being together with your family and friends and presents and all that. I love that stuff. And for movies, by the way, even though I love It's a Wonderful Life as a movie, I think I go with Die Hard. People will look at me strange that that's not really a Christmas movie, but it totally is. Just like Argyle says, Run DMC's Christmas in Hollis, Queens is a Christmas song. Die Hard is definitely a Christmas movie.
Well, then Die Hard's my favorite Christmas movie, too. I just want to wish everyone a very Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, everyone. And next week, we take a sharp right turn.
Oh, my goodness.
Jackie the Joke Man Martling, a 21 and up crowd we better get.
I am very excited. I'm getting my Baba Booey out already.
Have a great Christmas, everyone. Take care.
We hope you enjoyed the show. Don't forget to tune in next Thursday at 3 o'clock on 880 The Biz. If you want to send in your questions, comments, or ideas for shows, please email Jack Miller at GeltFinancial.com. Follow us on Facebook at Jack Miller Down to Business or on Twitter at HJackMiller1. Turn it up.